Well, I actually come to these things to hear the false but flattering things my students say about me. And it keeps you going. Thank you, my dear brother. You've been a delight to my soul, I'll tell you. Just seeing what you've done at your age is shocking. You really need to kick up your game. Well, I've enjoyed this so far. And yesterday we took a look at the importance of apologetics, and we've got to get this word out to the people in our churches, and we've got to start doing more of this, even if we don't feel we're good at it. It's okay. You have to start somewhere, and that was my message, that we increase the value of the life of the mind and of learning how to help people with their objections in the church. And I want to talk a little bit more about another reason why this is important, and in the process do a little bit of training and then have some time for some Q&A. Several years ago, I was speaking at a conference in Seattle. It was a Sunday morning, and I was in the airport getting ready to fly back to Southern California. And I got a copy of the Seattle Times, which is not an evangelical publication, by the way. And I made a beeline for the editorial page. And there on the front page of the opinion section was a massive editorial that was so large it spilled over into half of the second page. I noted that it was syndicated, which meant that it went out to several newspapers that morning, and it was called A Divided Nation. And it, pardon me for sipping so much water, I've got a horrible back pain. I went to Disneyland Tuesday and made the mistake of carrying my grandson around all day, and I blew my back out. And so I'm on muscle relaxant, pain medication, and something else, steroids. And that's why I'm so, so I'm not even sure where I'm at. But I opened up the paper, and there in the lead editorial was a statement called A Divided Nation. And the author went on to say that we live in the most divided period of American history since the Civil War. And I for one, believe that that has continued to be true since that was written about 8 years ago. Now, what shocked me was what he said was the root of our division. He said the fundamental root of our division is not political. Now that would have shocked 80 to 90% of the people in the country, because we have huge political divisions. He said the fundamental division is not over race or gender. But we know that we have racial and gender issues in this country that are important and that need to be addressed. But those weren't the fundamental issues. He said the fundamental issue was not socioeconomic. And I'm thinking, okay, what's he going to say? Well, he made the point that these are symptoms of a deeper underlying division that is the real issue. The real issue, he said, is a division over worldview. Worldview. Now, you've heard a worldview. I've heard a worldview. But outside the church, there aren't a lot of people that talk about worldview. So I practically fell off my chair there right in the airport when this guy said it's worldview. And he went on to say that the division of worldview is twofold. Now, he was that was the only place in the article where I think he was mistaken, because there really is a threefold division of worldview in American culture, and I will describe that division for you in just a minute. But the result of that worldview division is that now, for the first time, I think, in church history, could be wrong about that, you and I are not only considered to be ignorant and stupid and irrational for believing in the superstition Christianity, but we are also considered immoral for believing in Christianity. Now, this is new, because up until the beginning of the 20th century, even those who did not believe in the supernatural aspects of Christianity still thought that the ethics of Jesus was something to aspire to. And so now it's not only the truthfulness of Christianity, but it's the ethics of Jesus and his followers that is considered to be immoral. And to illustrate that, consider something that novelist Jane Smiley said about you and me. Here is how their ignorant bigotry works. Well, that's a nice way to start an article. First, they put the fear of God into you. If you don't believe the literal word of the Bible, you'll burn in hell. Of course, the literal word of the Bible is tremendously contradictory. And so you have to set aside all critical thinking and accept the very simplistic system of belief that you're not allowed to question. So no, we're not going to have Q&A today. A corollary to this point is that they make sure you understand that the devil resides in the toils and snares of complex thought, so it's best not to think at all. Okay, so we are a people that don't tolerate questions. It's dangerous to think. So if you got children or grandchildren, you want to train them to be loving. The last thing you want to do is train them to learn how to think and read and be critical thinkers. So if you're a grandparent or a parent, you're into that, shame on you. That's not Christianity, supposedly. Now, one more quotation, which really was kind of unbelievable for me. It comes from Robert Reich, who was the Secretary of Labor in the Clinton administration and a professor at Harvard, so a very smart guy. And in an online journal, he made the following assertion. The greatest conflict of the 21st century is not going to be between the West and terrorism. Well, you could have fooled me on that one. The terrorism is a tactic, it's not a belief. The true battle will be between modern civilization and anti-modernists, between those who believe in the primacy of the individual and those who believe that human beings owe their allegiance to a higher power, between those who give priority to life in this world and those who believe that human life is mere preparation for an existence beyond the grave, between those who believe in science, reason, and logic. Thank God you don't have any faculty on this campus that believe in science, reason, and logic. Whew, I was worried for a while there. And those who believe the truth is revealed through scripture and religious dogma. Terrorism will disrupt and destroy our lives, but terrorism is not the greatest danger we face. Conservative religion is. Now, stop and think about that for a minute. We used to be ignored. Now we are feared as undermining America. And there are about 20% of Americans who believe this sort of thing about you and about me, that not only are we ignorant because we build our whole religion on superstitious faith, but our moral values of anti-tolerance, of dogmatism, of bigotry, is out of step with the 21st century. Now, where is this coming from? Well, it's coming from three worldviews that have arisen in America in the 20th century. And these three worldviews began, one of them began in the, I'd say the teens, the 19-teens. The other one began somewhere around, I would say, in America in the 1950s. They both flowered in the 60s. And we're still dealing with these because they have the authority of culture, unfortunately. And what I want to do is to talk a little bit about these worldviews. Now, I'm happy to tell you that Christianity is still one of the three vibrant worldviews. We do have the local churches. There is, I'm glad to tell you, a growing academic influence by Christians in secular universities. In our profession, philosophy, there has been nothing short of an awakening that's been taking place. You can't pick up a journal in my field without some conservative Christian contributing an article to that journal. We're everywhere now, and it's getting worse. So that's the exciting thing, and I'm hoping that your department's going to pump some people into doctoral programs to serve Jesus as college teachers and university professors. We need that as well as intelligent, thoughtful, articulate pastors and parachurch workers. The second worldview is, in my opinion, by far the dominant worldview in the country. It's in the drinking water. You just absorb it on your mother's knee, and it has undermined Europe, and it's called scientific naturalism. Scientific naturalism. Now, this worldview has two components to it. The first component is a theory of knowledge, or how we know things. And this is the most important component. And according to the naturalist, the only knowledge that we can have of reality, or at least the very best knowledge that we can have of reality, is through the hard sciences. Physics, chemistry, neuroscience, geology, which is just one dirty dig after another. These are branches of study that give us knowledge of their subject matter. All other fields in the humanities, literature, political theory, philosophy, religion, give us opinions that no one knows who's right either way on these opinions. They're just opinion makers. But the hard sciences give us reliable knowledge of reality. I am editing a book that ought to come out in, I'd say, a year from this summer, that is going to be a game-changing book that's going to critique theistic evolution from a broad side. We've got 40 scholars in this book. 20 are from the UK, Scotland, Finland, and Europe. There are university professors there, and that about 20 are from North America. And this book is going to do a real job. And it's going to have science, philosophy, and theology in it. One of the things that one of the leading theistic evolutionists in the country, Carl Giberson, has said, is that science is by far our most secure, safe sort of knowledge of reality. Theology is an approach to reality that has to be taken by profound faith. By the way, the faith is profound because there's no evidence for it. That's profound, isn't it? So if science comes into conflict with theology, guess who loses? Theology. So now more and more Christian thinkers are believing that neuroscience has pretty much demonstrated that there is no such thing as a soul. And so when you die, you're extinct. And for Christians, maybe God resurrects you at the final day. The question is, how is that going to be me instead of a lookalike if I have different parts? So there's all kinds of nightmarish problems with this. Where's this coming from? I mean, you and I, we all know homosexuality is okay. There's nothing wrong with that. Gay marriage, what's your problem? The Bible's against it? Okay, we'll fiddle with it. We'll bring it up to speed. You know, we're constantly fiddling with the Bible to make sure that it teaches what our secular critics want it to teach, right? And so, eureka, we discovered that the Bible teaches that homosexuality is okay after all, and we just misunderstood it for 2,000 years. Well, there's something putrid in Peru, if you ask me, and that's one of them. So scientific naturalism has the attitude that the only kind of knowledge that is available to us about the real world is knowledge that comes from the hard sciences. All other approaches to reality give us personal opinions, things that may help us but aren't real, sort of like a placebo effect, and we have to retreat in religion to feeling and hope that it's true perhaps, but no one can know any theological claim is true. You just can't know those kind of things. Why? Because you can't test them in a lab. I was invited to an evangelistic dinner engagement years ago, and a friend told me he was bringing his boss, who'd been an engineer for 30 years and was going back to school and finishing up his PhD in physics from Johns Hopkins, and he hated Christianity and loved going after Christians. So I was at the hors d'oeuvre table, and I noticed my friend and an older gentleman, must have been his boss, and I was right, come in the room. And he came over to the hors d'oeuvre table, and we were introduced, and he just immediately launched into me and said, "Say, I understand that you're a philosopher and a theologian." And I said, "Well, you know, I give it my best shot." And he said, "Yeah." He said, "I used to be interested in that kind of stuff when I was a teenager. But when I grew up as an adult, I gave it up because I realized as a mature thinker that if you can't quantify your data and test it empirically in the lab, it's nothing but a bunch of hot air and opinion. And I want knowledge of reality. I don't want a bunch of opinion." That is scientism that he advanced. Now, another example of this is Time Magazine, and I'm giving you these examples so you won't think this is limited to the university community. Time Magazine had a cover story a few years back on how the universe is going to end. And they basically argued that it's going to wind up, which meant it's going to wind down and die a coal death, which means it had to be wound up, which means there needed to be a winder-upper. I mean, I don't know what they were missing on that one. But the idea that they said in the article was this: for centuries, indeed millennia, we've wanted to know how all this was going to end. Unfortunately, The only place we could go to find answers to our questions was religion and philosophy, which amount to nothing but idle speculation. But now, for the first time in human history, science has moved into this area of inquiry, and for the first time, we have gained answers to our questions. Now, you think about the difference between the authority of the doctor and the pastor in your community. The doctor carries authority. Usually, when he tells you, this is what's wrong with you, I want you to do this, you agree with him and listen to him, usually speaking. Pastor says such and such and thus and so. If you don't like it, you go to a different church. He didn't carry any authority. Now, what's that about? Naturalism. And so the second component of naturalism is called materialism or physicalism. That the entire universe is physical, or if there's anything non-physical, it emerged from matter and it depends on matter. So probably the best way to think about this is just everything's physical. Now, that means no soul, no life after death, no moral values, no God, no kingdom of God. There's just matter, and it is the way chemists and physicists tell us it is, and that's the end of it. The only creation story in town is going to be Darwinian evolution. And in my opinion, that sorry theory is propped up because the only alternative to it is religious. And we all know religion's superstitious. So we got to make the scientific theory work, even if the evidence isn't as strong as we'd like it to be, because there's no alternative. A religious alternative is not an alternative. So that's what's going on there. Now, the third worldview that is, by the way, the naturalist worldview dominates the media. The studies have indicated the vast majority of people who write in the power newspapers and are on major networks are naturalists. They're naturalists. The third worldview is postmodern relativism. And it's sometimes a little bit difficult to get your hand on what postmodern relativism is, because there's so many doggone versions of it. I mean, one of them is it's against a certain kind of architecture. And I don't know anything about architecture. But for our purposes, postmodernism is a form of relativism about reality, truth, and value. So it is a form of relativism about reality, truth, and value, where things are relative to your community, not to the individual. So you're a part of a community. That community has the same language and customs. And you construct reality and truth according to your approach to things. So if you're a Buddhist community, Buddhism is true for you. If you're the Christian community, Christianity is true for you Christians. Atheism is true for the atheist community, and nobody's wrong. Because there is no such thing as objective truth with a capital T. There are only local truths. Those are truths relative to your community. Values are relative to different groups who will have different values. This is why, one of the reasons why there's been so much emphasis on diversity training and diversity. Now, I see a point to that. We all need to learn to be sensitive to the way we hear things. I think that's very important. I think that's a good thing. But the diversity training that's going on now says that we ought to get our primary identity from our ethnicity. And I don't see that in the New Testament. I see my primary identity that should come from being a human being made in God's image and as a part of the body of Christ. And then secondly, I can get some of my identity from my social group or ethnic group or what have you. I don't think there's anything wrong with that as long as it's in the proper order. So postmodern relativism is propagated largely through the media and through movies, through the entertainment industry, and through literature. In college, it's usually through the communication department, the sociology department, and the anthropology department. Even at Biola, which has been a very conservative school, we have serious problems at our school in the sociology department and the anthropology department, even as I'm speaking to you, because relativism is starting to creep out of those departments to their students. And we got some decisions and some problems facing us in the future here. So now, as an example of postmodernism, my wife and I were on a trip from the West Coast to North Carolina to speak at a Christian high school training convention. What a privilege that was. Christian school teachers are just, they're champs, man. We thank God for them. And on the plane over there, there was a movie that was made by amateurs, but it won the Film Festival Award in Hollywood for the best amateur movie that had been produced that year. It was actually a pretty well done movie. It was called A Stolen Summer. And it was a story of two little boys who were living in Chicago, and they were out for Christmas, for a summer break. And one boy was, I'm going to say, about 12 or 13 years old, and he was a Catholic. And his little friend was about 9, and he was Jewish. And all through the summer, the Catholic boy was worried about his Jewish friend going to hell. And so he got him on his knees in his garage one day when they were playing and told him to pray to Jesus and to confess his sins. And the little guy did it. And he took him one day to meet his priest, and the priest talked to him and so on and so forth. So he did the best he could to bring his little Jewish friend to Jesus, as well as he understood what that meant. Well, toward the end of the summer, the little Jewish boy contracted a very a serious disease, and he died. Last scene of the movie is at the boy's funeral. And awkwardly in the hallway, the young Catholic boy bumps into the mom and dad of the deceased Jewish boy. It's a very awkward moment. And the little Christian fellow says, little Catholic boy says to the parents, I cannot tell you how sorry I am for the way I treated your son all summer. Because now I have come to understand that when it comes to God, it doesn't matter what you believe. What matters is that you're earnest and that you're loving. And I am so, so sorry. And they forgave him. And that was the message of the movie. That when it comes to God, it just doesn't matter what you believe. That's irrelevant. There's no truth that's true anyway. So whatever's true for you, believe that. What matters is that you're earnest and sincere and so on. That's postmodernism. Now, why am I taking the time to alert you to this? Well, for one reason, I would like you to start thinking a little bit more worldviewishly. I'd like you to listen to the news. I'd like you to read things online with a worldview perspective. And that's, again, why, if you can, take a philosophy or an apologetics class that will teach you how to spot the different tenets of the different worldviews. That can be very, very helpful to you. But the second reason I'm bringing this up is that these other two worldviews, naturalism and postmodernism, don't agree about everything, but there's one thing they agree on. And that is that there is no such thing as knowledge outside the hard sciences. Postmodernism believes that because they don't believe there's any knowledge, period. And scientific naturalism believes that because they think that the hard sciences are all there is. So they both agree that if there's going to be knowledge, it's going to be in chemistry and physics, and that's it. Now, why does that matter? Well, and try to understand this statement, it is knowledge that gives people the authority to act and speak in public. Knowledge gives people the right to speak in public. It gives them the right to define reality for the rest of the American people. Okay? So, yeah, if the evening news wants to know what's happening in these killings in our high schools, they interview a psychiatrist or a psychologist or somebody with a white lab coat on. That's usually not by accident. That gives them authority because they're looking for knowledge in answer to the questions. And psychiatrists have the right to speak with knowledge, with authority about the reality of youth culture because they're scientists. Interview youth ministers? No, they don't know anything. They're nice people, probably, but they just don't know anything. And so you don't want to interview a youth minister because all he's got's a bunch of superstitious feelings for his little religious group over there, and we're looking for real answers. So you remember Columbine years ago? I mean, that, you know, for a whole week the country, I think in those days it was Tom Brokaw and Dan Rather and Peter Jennings, they were looking for answers to what was going on. Were ministers involved? Yeah, they provided comfort to the families, and that meant they got to sing the national anthem before the game began. But once the game began, it was scientists who were turned to diagnose and give us answers as to what happened. Newsweek magazine the next week on the cover had this article: does a defect in brain chemistry cause crimes like Columbine? Now, there was not a single theologian or Christian ethicist or a Christian pastor that was asked to give his or her opinion about these subjects because we are not considered as in possession of a body of knowledge as Christians. And that's a big deal because faith doesn't matter. Beliefs don't matter. They don't even matter to you. Because like I said last night, if you go to a doctor for help and he says that I have very deep held faith, you know, about the kidneys or your knee, and I hold them very passionately. In fact, to tell you the truth, I'm so deeply committed to it that I formed a group, and every Sunday morning we meet and we sing songs about the kidneys. And I give a little message on the kidneys. We're trying to raise money to send missionaries to other countries to spread our teachings about kidneys. And we've got very deep faith that kidneys are this way. You're not looking for that. You're looking for somebody who knows something about kidneys. And that goes to a golf instructor. That goes to anybody who works on your car. People get the right to act in public only if we think they have knowledge about what they're doing. Does that make sense? You want to cut Christianity off at the knees? Present a picture of it that says it's got this book, the Bible, and they have deeply held beliefs and emotions and feelings about the Bible. You ask them a question about why they think it's true. They can't answer it. They don't know. You ask them, do you know this is true? Oh, no. That would be contrary to faith. We believe it's true. We have faith in it. And so you can disregard those people. They're idiots. We don't have to listen to them. And they don't listen to us. When was the last time you saw Christian leaders speaking in public on a major forum and doing it in an articulate way? Last time was Catholic priests, and thank God they're trained to think. But we don't value learning in our community. We value being a good megachurch public preacher. And that's a good thing, but that's should be a both and, not an either or. So now, what is at issue today is not whether or not Christianity is true. That comes as a shock to some people. And of course, there are a lot of people that don't think Christianity is true. But what is at issue is whether or not Christianity can be known to be true. So I can go on a college campus and I can tell them, I think Christianity is true, because Jesus changed my life. And people will yawn and ask me if I'd like a donut, and I will be summarily dismissed. If I go on a campus and say, not only is Christianity true, but you can actually know it's true, and not only that, you're irrational if you don't believe it, that's like teeing off a golf ball in the shower. It comes right back at you pretty quickly. And people don't want to, they don't want to hear that. And so what we need to deal with is this question. Is Christianity a knowledge tradition or a faith tradition? That is, are the central teachings of mere Christianity items that we can actually know to be true, or are the central teachings of Christianity something that no one knows is true, but we can accept by simply an act of trust or blind faith? I maintain that the church has always held that Christianity was a source of knowledge of reality. But we will have, you know, faith Lutheran church, not knowledge Lutheran church, because we've kind of lost touch with the knowledge game. So in the time I have left, I want to try to explain what it is I mean by saying that Christianity is a source of knowledge, so that you will be clear on this. So I'm going to define some terms for you, and then we'll have a little time of Q&A. Okay, first of all, what is truth? Let me give you a simple definition of truth. Truth is a matching between thought or belief and reality. Truth is a matching or a corresponding between thought or a belief and reality. If I have the thought run through my mind, grass is green, and if grass is actually green, my thought is true. It may be true even if I don't believe it. Suppose a blind guy has the thought go through his mind, grass is green, and he doesn't have a clue one way or the other. Well, his thought's still true, even though he doesn't believe it, because it matches reality. You see, reality is disgustingly indifferent to your beliefs. Indeed, reality is what you bump up against when your beliefs are false. Truth is a matching with reality, whether you believe the truth or not. Okay? So truth is like larger than. You can't have larger than unless you have two things, a short thing and a large thing. That makes sense? You can have yellow with only one thing. If there was one thing in this room, yellow could be in the room. You could have a yellow sheet of paper. You couldn't have larger than in the room if there weren't two things, the smaller and the larger. And you can't have truth in the room unless you've got a thought or a belief on the one, or an assertion on the one hand, and reality on the other. So truth requires two things, an assertion or a thought or a belief, and reality, and they match with one another. Now, how do I know this is the correct definition of truth? I mean, somebody could just say, well, that's your definition. Okay, well, what you do at that point is you give them a simple story. So they challenge that this is just your definition of truth. And so you answer by giving them a simple story. And I'm going to use the bookstore story. So I get called from the bookstore at the university, and they say, Thomas Nagel's book, Mind and Cosmos, that you ordered is in. You can come and pick it up. So I form a thought. Thomas Nagel's book, Mind and Cosmos, is at the bookstore. I don't know if it's true or not. The bookstore's lied to me on several occasions just to get me over there to sign a book for somebody. So, you know, I don't trust those guys. All right, so I'm thinking, well, I'm going to flip a coin on this dude, but I want to know if that is. So I don't go swimming in the Pacific Ocean. What do? My thought says, if you're going to see if this is true, you got to go to the bookstore. So I go to the bookstore, and on the way over there, my dear friend, Professor Gould, is on campus lecturing. And he doesn't know why I'm going to the bookstore. He just wants to talk. So we're chatting. We both go in the bookstore. And at the very same time, we see the book on the shelf. Would you admit at that moment we have an experience in common? What is that experience? Somebody raise your hand and tell me what the experience is. Yes. Bingo. We both see the books on the shelf right there. Absolutely. I have a second experience he doesn't have. Because I don't just see the book. I also experience the fact that my thought about the book is true. And I might express that second experience by going, aha, I was right. Or they were telling me the truth. Now, the reason he doesn't have the second experience is because he hasn't had his morning coffee. And no, it's actually because he hasn't formed the thought. The book is in the bookstore because he's thinking about something else. Could he form the thought? Yeah. And if he formed the thought and saw the book was there, he would have what? He would have truth. He would not have knowledge. He would have truth. Now, truth is that matching relationship between the thought and the book. And so I step back and I say, okay, see the book. What was my thought? That the book was there. Gosh darn, guess what? They match. And I do that enough times, and I think, I need an English word for that matching deal. Truth. If it doesn't match, it's not truth. Right? When your checkbook doesn't match the thing in a bank, falsehood. Okay. Now, I know, and those are bad moments. Now, when Jesus said, I am the truth, I have no idea what that means if we interpret it as him saying, I am the same thing as truth. My head starts exploding. Jesus can't be the same thing as truth because Jesus is a person and truth is a non-personal relationship of matching between a thought and reality. So Jesus is not the same thing as truth. What does it mean then when he says that? It means one of two things. It either means I am the source of truth. Okay, so that could very well be what he means. Just like when he says I'm the life, that means I'm the source of life. Or it might mean that I am the thing that matches. Just like the book. I'm the book. I'm the thing that matches. In other words, for centuries after centuries after centuries, there's been a picture of this promised Messiah that was going to come. And guess what? I match it. I'm the real deal. I'm not an imposter. I'm not lying. I'm the real deal. I'm the one that matches what you've been expecting for 1,500 years. I'm it. He means one of those two things, but he doesn't mean he's the same thing as truth. Although there would be no truth without God, if you ask me, because God's the source of truth, but that doesn't mean God's the same thing as truth. Even though God's the source of dogs, that doesn't mean he's the same thing as a dog. So let's not get confused on that. Now, what is knowledge? Knowledge is not the same thing as truth. And this is where it gets really, I think, very practical and interesting. There are three kinds of knowledge. One of them is called knowledge by acquaintance. And I think Travis actually did his dissertation on this, didn't he, at Iowa? So he's probably forgotten more about this subject than I know. If you want to know something more about it, please talk to him. But basically, knowledge by acquaintance is knowledge by being directly aware of something, by just being aware of it, by seeing it. So I have knowledge by acquaintance with the exit sign by seeing it, by looking at it. I have knowledge by acquaintance with my dear sister here in the front row by just looking around. All of a sudden I notice her and I see her. I have knowledge by direct awareness of her. Do you understand? Now, this is not limited to your five senses. You can have knowledge by acquaintance with your own conscious life. You can say, am I angry? And you introspect and you become aware of anger. Well, that's knowledge by acquaintance with a state of consciousness that you can't see, touch, taste, smell, or hear. But that's knowledge by acquaintance. Now, you don't need to know how to think, and you don't need to have concepts in order to have knowledge by acquaintance. I'm sure, for example, that fish or frogs have knowledge by acquaintance. They become aware of the presence of a fly. But I don't think they can have the thought, there's a fly, because I don't think they are able to have concepts because they don't have minds. I do think they have souls, but they don't have minds. Now, a little child learns to be acquainted with red before he ever forms a concept of red. So the little child sees red several times. After seeing it several times, he's able to kind of pull away from any particular red object and see what they had in common and form a concept of red in his mind. He still can't speak it because he doesn't have a word for the concept. But he sees mom keep going, red, red, and after a while he says, gosh, maybe that's got something to do with the color. And the little guy or little gal, how they do this is literally a miracle. Literally. I have no idea how kids learn language. It is a miracle. But the little guy or little gal says, red, mommy. A red, daddy, and then again your head starts exploding because the thing's a miracle. But notice that they had knowledge by acquaintance before they were able to think about the object. Now, when I tell you Christianity gives us knowledge, the first thing I mean by that is that it provides knowledge by acquaintance with the unseen world. Okay? There have been times when I have been aware of the presence of demons. I was in a big meeting where Josh McDowell was speaking in a gym. I was at half court. There were 2,500, 3,000 people in the meeting. And he hadn't started talking yet. And I was talking to some people. And I had a jolt. And I felt darkness and evil come in the gym. And I looked over, and I noticed three guys had come in. And I could feel across the gym this sense of darkness and evil in them before I'd even looked at them. Noted where they sat. After the meeting, I made a beeline to those guys to talk to them. Sure enough, they were all three involved in satanic occult work, and they were there to undermine and curse the meeting. I was acquainted with the presence of those demons in that gym. And I can't believe that there aren't other people in this room. When you've gone into a place, you just swoo, you feel darkness. There's just an evil, dark presence there. That's knowledge. It's knowledge by acquaintance. You can have knowledge by acquaintance with angels. I have three angels that regularly guard me. There's a taller one behind my back and two short ones on either side of me. Some of you, you know, it's so funny when I tell this, I get people grinning at me. Because most of you don't believe in angels. You really don't. You'd sign it off on a doctrinal statement with mild intellectual assent, but they play absolutely no role in your life. Okay, I'll tell you how I know I got angels around me. 6-7 years ago, I was speaking at a church up in the Northwest. After I spoke, a woman comes up to me, "Thank you for that lecture, it was wonderful. By the way, the hour you were speaking, there were three angels standing around you, a tall one behind you, and two short ones on either side." I thought the lady was nuts. And I told the pastor, "Who is that?" You know, he says, "Well, she's really a very godly woman." I still thought she was nuts. So I just bagged it. This was April or May, and I just, get me out of here. I got home, and that next fall, it was about the first week of September. I was going through a hard time, been a believer 35 years, and I prayed a prayer that I'd never prayed in 35 years. I'd always asked the Holy Spirit's help, but I'd never asked for him to send his angels to minister to me, like they did the Lord Jesus, and to protect me. So I said, "Lord, I don't know if those angels were real or not, but if they were real and they're not here, would you send them back to guard me and would you let me know they're here?" Okay, prayed that, went to sleep. A week and a half later, I got an email from one of my graduate students, Mark Stepp. Mark is a pastor now, his wife's finishing a doctorate at USC. Mark said, "JP, I've been sitting on this email for 3 days because I was afraid to send it to you. And I talked to a group of the students, including Gary Osmondson, and they all said, you need to send this to JP, so here goes. About 3-4 days ago, when you were lecturing on metaphysics in Meyer 109, I sit over near the window, and for 15 minutes, I saw three angels appear around you. There was a taller one behind you and two short ones on either side, and then they disappeared. And if you'd like to talk about it, I'd love to come to your office." Well, man, I got on the phone and said, "Get your rear end over here right now." And so he comes over to my office, and I said, "Mark, what the heck happened?" And he said, "Well, I looked over there, JP, and all of a sudden there were three robed figures, I couldn't see faces, standing around you. It was like they were guarding you. There were two shorter ones and a tall one. In fact, I drew a picture of it, and I've got it at home." He drew this picture of what it looked like from his vantage point. And he said, I started rubbing my eyes like crazy. I know a guy that sat behind him that day, Ed Bort. And I told this story a few years later, and Ed said, I remember the day. I said, how do you remember the day? He said, it was early September, and I sat behind Mark, and Dr. Moreland, the guy was going nuts. He was like there was acid in his eyes. He was rubbing his eyes, and he was going crazy. So that was confirmed, and I said, Mark, were they in your head or in the room? Oh, no, they were in the room right next to you. Well, do you see angels a lot? Thinking he was just kind of a kook. And he said, I've never seen an angel in my life. And I said, were they in the room or in your head? They were up in the room. Why didn't you tell me? Oh, yeah. Hey, Dr. Moreland, I thought you'd like to know there are three angels standing around you while you're lecturing. So I was scared to death. And I said, this is what you don't know. About 4 days before you saw them, I prayed that God would send them back and let me know they were there. And he starts weeping in my office because he was the answer to that prayer. He didn't see five or seven, he saw three. This summer, I got an email from a lawyer who had come to see me 3 years ago at my office because he was filled with anxiety and depression. He wanted to talk. And he said, Dr. Moreland, I've been holding on to this for 3 years. And I kept the email, by the way. He said, I thought I should tell you. I've been holding this inside. When I came into your office, there was light, a radiant glow all throughout your office. When you got me on my knees and put your hands on me to pray for me, I felt presences come in the room. And I opened my eyes, and you don't have to believe me, but I saw three angels standing around you, a taller one behind you and two shorter ones on either side, and it was unbelievable. Well, I emailed him and said, have you heard anything about any of this stuff? And he emailed me back and said, I'm sorry, but I don't have any idea what you're talking about. Three confirmations. Those people had knowledge by acquaintance with the presence of angels that other people around them weren't able to have. Okay? Now, have you ever been aware of the presence of God? Have you ever had a time when you sensed he showed up and he's there? Maybe it's in worship where there's just a sense, this isn't ordinary worship day. This is a visitation time. God's here. Maybe it's on your knees in your home. Who knows? That is knowledge. You were actually acquainted with God's presence. And that's knowledge by acquaintance. Christianity gives knowledge by acquaintance. The second kind of knowledge is very important, and it's called propositional knowledge. And this is a true belief based on adequate reasons. Propositional knowledge is true belief based on adequate reasons. Okay? So if I say to you, I know George Washington was the first president of the United States, or I know that there are at least 20 people in this room right now, I have to, it's first of all, got to be true. If I said I know there are 20 people in the room, and I later found out that there were all mannequins and there weren't any people in the room, then I would say, well, I thought I knew it, but apparently I was mistaken. I withdraw my claim to know it. So it's got to be true. The second thing, if you're going to have propositional knowledge, is you got to believe it. And that means that you have between 51 and 100% certainty you're right. So if you are 55-45 on something, you believe it. You just believe it weakly. Now, I'm going to take a parenthesis for a minute. Would you hear my heart for a second? Would you just hear my heart for a second? More damage has been done to people by telling them that if you believe something, you're certain of it. You don't have any doubts or any questions. That is nonsense. If you're 55-45, I'm 55-45, the Chiefs are going to make the Super Bowl next year. Yeah, is that very strong? No. That's a kind of a, but I don't disbelieve it, or I'd be below 50%, and I'm not 50-50. So I do believe it weekly. I used to be 65-35 that prayer worked. Now I'm 85-15, because I went to work on bumping that thing up. I'm 90-10 that God exists. I'm 100% zero that I exist. Okay? So, you don't want to ask yourself the question, what do I believe? You also want to ask yourself the question, what is the strength of my belief on a given topic? And then you can actually go to work on increasing the strength of that belief by reading things, by experimenting, asking people if they've ever seen answers to prayer or what have you. Okay, but truth, knowledge is a true belief. It's true, and you take it. You actually take it to be true to some degree. And it's got to be based on adequate reasons. So now let me illustrate. Here's a guy at Newport Beach. He drinks 24/7. And, he that's all he does. But he's formed the habit of believing everything on the stall, on the second stall in the men's room at Newport Beach. His motto is, the stall says it, I believe it, that settles it. So he goes in there one day, and it says on the stall, George Washington was first president of the United States. He's never heard of George Washington. He doesn't even know what a president is. He's content just to hang around Newport Beach. But that government says it, and I believe it. Now compare him with a historian who believes truly that George Washington was the first president of the United States. But he's got some evidence for that. He's done some work on the congressional records in those days. He's read a few newspaper articles. Now, what do our two friends have in common? They got two things in common. They both have the truth, right? They both believe the truth. But one is lucky, and the other actually knows the truth. So what's the difference between having the truth and believing it versus knowing the truth? The person who knows the truth has got adequate grounds for believing the truth. The other person has got blind luck. So knowledge is a true belief based on adequate grounds. Note, I did not say based on certainty. There is intellectual certainty, and that is when it is completely impossible that you're wrong. Completely impossible. Is it completely impossible that I'm wrong about God's existence? No. It's possible I'm mistaken that there's no God. Do I have any good reason to think I'm mistaken? No. I know God exists, because I have a true belief based on strong, adequate reasons. But at this point in my life, I don't have any doubts about that, but it's okay if you do. I have earlier. You can have a doubt and still know God exists. You can have unanswered questions and know God exists, because knowledge doesn't require intellectual certainty. About the only thing you're intellectually certain about is your own existence, and 2 and 2 is 4. That's about it. So you can know God exists without having to be certain. So relax. If you have days when you have some doubts about it or questions you don't know how to answer, you can still know God exists if you have a true belief about his existence and it's based on some adequate reasons. That's why you need to familiarize yourself at least a little bit with some apologetic arguments and a little bit of philosophical argumentation to shore up your adequate reasons. Does that make sense to you? And when you learn why you believe, you translate true belief into knowledge. Because true belief is not knowledge. Knowledge is true belief based on adequate reasons. The third kind of knowledge that Christianity gives is skill or know-how. And that's the ability to do something well. My father-in-law could look at a car, and I'm not kidding, in 15 minutes he knew what was wrong with it. Drove me nuts. And I'd say, well, what? How did you know? And he said, I don't know. I can't tell you. I just know. He'd come home for Christmas, and I would have been working. He'd come visit for Christmas, and I would have been working for 2 hours on some stupid toy I bought the kids that I was saying, I'll never do this again. And there are a bunch of empty parts. And I say, would you help me? First thing he does is throws the instructions away and puts the thing together in 30 minutes. And I'm looking at him like, get out of my house, you know. And he had know-how or skill. The Bible is filled with skill. It's called wisdom. It gives us know-how about prayer. It gives us skill about forgiving. It gives us know-how about how to relate to other people and God and goodness gracious. So when I claim that Christianity is a source of knowledge, I mean three things. First, it provides us with direct experiences of God and the unseen world. Secondly, it gives us true beliefs about God that are based on good, solid reasons, even if the reasons aren't 100% certain. And then it gives us skill and ability to do things well through its teachings. Boy, I'm telling you, I'm thankful for the Bible in that regard. Because if you want to know how to be a good dad, you know, I want to know what love is. You don't want to listen to those dudes. You don't want a dad that listens to them for their information. I would suggest that you go to 1 Corinthians 13, if you don't mind. And I think that's probably a fairly good place to start if you want to know what love is. So, Christianity is a source of knowledge. And please tell people that. Don't back off. Don't be a wimp. Don't say, well, this is what I believe, because you can't answer a question. Say, no, we know this is true, but I can't answer it, but I'll get you an answer. Now, I think my time's up. Is my time up? Well, my time's up. Thank you. Thank you.
So there'll be a panel discussion at the end of the conference, and if you have any questions about this talk, that would be a great time
don't
to
ask
sort
any
of
questions.
Okay, don't ask actually. Don't ask any of those questions. All right, we're going to do a 15-minute break, and then we'll come back into this room for another plenary talk by Mark Lanier. So there's some treats out there and some more coffee.